Another logistic remark I should make is that if you feel a little bit tired, you might have traveled in the morning, please feel free to take a nap. I think sleeping in talks is quite harmless. Sleeping can be dangerous when you drive, so if you, especially if the traffic is heavy, there's a dense collection of cars moving in one direction. If you fall asleep at the wheel, the differential velocity between you and the next car may cause a collision. I'm mentioning it because today I'd like to talk about a system which is quite similar, and these are, of course, sand dunes. In Poland, we've got very famous sand dunes in Słowiński National Park. If you haven't heard of them, shame on you. Shame on you. If you have, you might have also heard that they are moving, and this is the motion of dunes which makes them similar to cars. Indeed, in some countries, the dune traffic is quite heavy. This is a dune field from Arabian Peninsula. These are so-called Barkin dunes with these characteristic crescenting shapes, and the orientation of the horns tell us where the wind goes, so the wind blows sort of down the slide, and that's also where all the dunes are moving. So very much like cars, they move in one direction, and if there's a differential velocity between any two, it would lead to a dune-dune collision. Indeed, the migration rate of a dune, the motion rate of a dune, depends on essentially two factors. First of all, on the wind conditions, here characterized by the single velocity u, and it's inversely related to dune's own size. So dune move fundamentally because we keep moving grains from one end of the dune to the other. The action of the wind is equivalent to a little conveyor belt, which moves grains up the slope and then deposits them on the other side. And now the numerator f of u tells you about the power of our transporting machine. The stronger we blow, the more grains we can move per unit time. And H, in some vague sense, characterizes how much sand we have to work through. Now, in a dune field like that, people would say U is constant. Wind conditions are the same for all dunes. So the only thing which matters is H. And this is problematic because it means that small dunes move faster. And if there's a small dune upwind of a big dune, it inevitably should collide. If cars obeyed that relationship, I would actively discourage you from driving, because it would mean that small cars always bump into big ones. Fortunately, we've got some sort of feedback mechanism whereby drivers can adjust their speed based on visual input, and surprisingly, dunes may have something similar. That's precisely what I'd like to talk about today, the repulsion mechanism between dunes which can prevent collisions. In order to show it, I'm going to invite you to our laboratory. In our mathematics department, it's a little unusual. We've got a big fluid dynamics laboratory in the basement when people investigate various problems from biological fluids to ocean dynamics. You can also encounter our dune-making machine. This is a narrow channel. A wind is replaced by water. A curious feature of our system is that the channel is not straight, it's circular, so it's more of a dune roundabout rather than a dune highway. And the flow is induced by the sort of assembly of paddles submerged at the top. A remark for the experts in the audience is a highly, fully turbulent flow. It will be important later. And for now, I'll just say at the bottom, you can see our lab version of a dune field. You can see the collection of dunes moving in one direction, separate heaps of sand separated by patches of berg ground. At the moment, you've got, I think, 9 of them, which is awfully complicated, so I'm going to reduce the number of dunes to 2. In order to make 2 dunes, it's best to put in our channel 2 heaps of sand. Upon initializing the flow, each of them quickly molds into this characteristically asymmetric dune shape, and then they start migrating. So let us pause at this step 2. These are dunes of equal volume, and they are immersed in the same stream, so that's all the reason to assume, to suspect, that they would migrate at the same rate. Surprisingly, it does not happen, and they never collide. They always separate. It's nicely summarized in this sort of space-time diagram, very fancy. Here, space is characterized by an angle because our domain is periodic, so it goes from 0 to 360 degrees, also known as 2 pi. You could glue the left-hand side to the right, doesn't matter. And the time evolves from 0 to 80 minutes. At the beginning, at time 0, let's see if this works. Oh, wonderful. At time 0, we start with 2 dunes close to each other, and as the time progresses, both of them migrate downwind. But as they migrate, the separation distance between them keeps increasing, and about an hour into the experiment, they equilibrate in a fully antipodal position, 180 degrees. It's as far as they can get in our tank. It's how much they hate each other. They want to be far away. Another thing you can get from this diagram is that the blue dune maintains constant speed, just keeps going. You can tell by the fact that the blue line is straight, and it is the red one which is significantly faster at the beginning, and then it escapes and its migration rate converges to the migration rate of its neighbor. So the dune-dune feedback we've got here is fundamentally directional. It is the blue dune which politely asks the red dune to move on. It's not exactly true, because dunes, very much like drivers, are not always polite. And in fact, the blue dune almost literally pushes the red one. What I mean by that, when you look closely at the surface of the dune, you are going to see some sand and water or air. And in between these two phases, we've got a thin layer of moving grains which roll and slide along the interface. In case of the blue dune, it's sort of a nice continuous laminar motion, whereas for the red dune, its surface almost literally boils. And what I mean by that is that the continuity of sediment transport here is intermittently interrupted by this sort of bursting. Maybe it's better to show it instead of explaining. That's what the flow may look like around the dune. Here, it's sort of nice, streamlined, and smooth, but in this region, which is known as the wake, the flow is messy. We would say it's turbulent. You might encounter turbulence when you ever be on a plane. It would be all nice here. If the plane moves into this area, the pilot might tell you to fasten your seatbelt. So this turbulent wake is forming behind the blue dune. It's what wakes up the red dune and prevents collisions. So the question, the answer to the question, burning question we've always had, why dunes do not fall asleep at the wheel, is turbulence. Okay, and it sounds simple, but in fact it's a very complicated matter. Turbulence looks complex. And despite long-standing interest, here you've got sketches from Da Vinci himself, incidentally, on wakes behind obstacles, on turbulent wakes, but despite long history, we still struggle to understand the structure and make predictions about turbulent flows, yet they are all around us. If only we could visualize the fluid motion in this, the air motion in this room, you'd be amused by the richness of structure. All of you keep generating little turbulent jets as you breathe. And turbulence is important for many industrial problems. Let's not forget, I'm sponsored by an oil company. And it's critical for the environment. It's critical for making predictions about the climate. And as we've seen in the example today, which I tried to pull out of my own research, it may be important for shaping the landscapes in deserts in that it controls the migration rate of dunes, which annoyingly keep moving and may interact with our infrastructure. But fortunately, the good news is that now we understand a little bit better the dynamics. And another good news is that now I'm going to stop talking and you'll have opportunity to generate a lot of interesting turbulence by clapping your hands and asking questions.